there be shooters. When Capcom first began releasing games for the Nintendo Entertainment System beginning in 1986, they were strictly arcade-to-home ports, such as 1942 and Ghosts and Goblins. While these two were ported by revered developers Micronix...
Oh, by the way, I was being sarcastic.
Well, duh.
When games were developed in-house, Capcom had the tendency to add a bit more substance for the at-home player. Commando introduced hidden rooms and power-ups in its NES version, and continued this trend with Trojan. But other games would often be completely rehauled from its arcade counterpart, such as Bionic Commando, and it all started with Section Z. The arcade version of Section Z was released in 1985, and Capcom, having already dabbled in the vertical shooter genre, looked to change things up a bit in the form of a horizontal one. Set sometime in the third millennium, you control an astronaut tasked with saving planet Earth from a villainous alien invasion. The screen scrolls horizontally as the protagonist can move freely about, firing from a pea shooter while simultaneously hurling bombs below. One button attacks, while the other is designated to turn your astronaut around, enabling him to shoot either to the right or left. You traverse 26 sections, from A to Z, and even fly through vertical corridors where you're met with baddies attacking from both sides of the screen. Like all Capcom arcade games during this era, Section Z is painfully brutal. The NES version changed things up drastically. In this iteration, you still control a heroic astronaut, only now going under the moniker Captain Commando. Capcom tried hard to shamelessly sell this character as their mascot, going through several cosmetic changes before finally settling on the one that would star in his own game. I'm not calling this dude Captain Commando, so let's just stick with Astronaut. Anyway, Section Z on the NES retains several of the core elements from the coin-op machine, such as firing your weapon in both the right and left directions, using the A and B buttons respectively. The sections, however, no longer corresponded to letters of the alphabet, instead assigning each section or room to a number, 1 through 60. The game is broken up into three large areas, each consisting of 20 sections apiece, not four stages as stated in the manual or through sections A to Z. Capcom's early NES manuals were notorious for providing incorrect info, not to mention peppered with spelling and grammatical errors. Yuck. Once thrust into the bowels of the alien base, the enemy onslaught is relentless. You start out with 20 hit points, which are decreased by 1 each time you take a bullet. Not too bad, right? Touch an enemy directly, however, and it's an instant dirt nap, minus the dirt. Section Z mercifully allows you to continue from the current section once all of your lives have been exhausted, each with 5 hit points less than when you perished. But the real kick in the kiwis happens when all of your HP is drained to 0. Regardless of how many lives you have in stock, this results in you being sent all the way back to the beginning of the area with a replenished life force of 20 hit points. This can be absolutely frustrating, resulting in the hurling of your controller across the room, but it isn't all bad. We'll touch more on that in a minute here. Your astronaut can initially pick up 2 different types of primary weapons. The Mega Master is the stronger of the two, which penetrates alien scum with brute force, while the Flash Buster fires a 3-way shot with limited range. You can combine these guns once both are obtained to create the ultimate weapon. A barrier shield can also be found throughout, which is a lifesaver as it can absorb 32 shots directly to the front, similar to the shield in Gradius. The bitch of it all, though, is that you have to tap the D-pad to the right and then press select to equip your guns and barrier. Just imagine how much of a pain this is when you're completely surrounded by enemy projectiles. Yeah, it's just as bad as it sounds. How many times had I replaced my ultimate weapon with a weaker one when attempting to don a shield? More than I'd care to admit. You also have secondary weapons that can be used by pressing the A and B buttons at the same time, but again, during the heat of battle, this can be more trouble than it's worth, not to mention this eats up 4 hit points with every use, so I avoided using these altogether, wishing not to flirt with disaster by draining my precious health. Thankfully, life can be replenished, minutely I may add, by collecting health pickups of 3 hit points apiece. The best way to gain more is by finding the many hidden life warps, which can be uncovered by firing in just the right spot, but you'll need to choose the correct path. The left one is the safe bet. And speaking of choosing the correct path, the majority of sections end with the choice of 1 or 2 different paths to take. Most will send you to ascending sections, while others may send you back, which isn't necessarily a bad thing. You'll eventually come across red paths that are inaccessible until its corresponding generator is destroyed. These are located within the same area, so it's a good idea to note which two sections house these paths, as you'll need to return to them later. In fact, unless you have the memory of an elephant, you're better off mapping where each path takes you if you want to even remotely be successful in this game. Or you can be like me and say, fuck that noise, and use a guide. No shame in going that route for a 33-year-old game. I'm down to draw maps for Kid Icarus, but not Section Z. Each area then concludes with the boss fight before transporting you along to the next one. This rewards you with an increase of max HP, as does the annihilation of a generator. The game graciously only sends you back to the beginning of each area when your hit points are depleted, so in this case, sections 20 and 40 respectively. Thank the gaming gods for small miracles, albeit with only 20 hit points replenished. Damn you, Capcom! At least you don't have to locate and destroy the generators again. Section Z's environments are fairly bland, with dull enemies to match. Yawn! The music is as equally narcoleptic, with each area boasting of its own tune, coupled with hidden room and boss themes. I usually dig Capcom's NES music from this era, but not in this case. It's not bad, but it's not all that great either. Meh. Section Z is a brutally unforgiving game. It was released in Japan a few months prior to North America's for the Famicom Disk System and included a much-needed save feature. That's probably my biggest issue with ours. Without the ability to save, or at the very least a password, the game must be completed in a single sitting. While I can appreciate how ambitious Capcom was with this version, opting for a more thorough experience versus a simple arcade port, the absence of a save feature hinders this one in my eyes. Thankfully, the game is fairly inexpensive, and while it's the furthest thing from a traditional shooter, it's still chock full of typical late 80s action.